Hello and welcome to The Big Picture. I'm Tina Jha. India has just 1% of the world's vehicles, but accounts for nearly 11% of the global road accidents and 10% of road crash victims worldwide. These alarming statistics have been pointed out in a World Bank report titled Traffic Crash Injuries and Disabilities, the Burden on Indian Society, prepared in association with the NGO Save Life Foundation. Releasing the report on Saturday, Union Minister for Road Transport and Highways, Nitin Gadkari, termed the road accident scenario in India more dangerous than the ongoing COVID pandemic. He said the accident cost is a tremendous burden to society and the country, as the estimated cost of one death in one road accident is around 91 lakh rupees. The financial impact of the crash is much more on the poorer households. Now, as per the report, more than 75% poor households in the country reported a decline in their income as a result of a road traffic accident. So on the show today, we will analyze the key findings of the World Bank report that has been prepared in association with Save Life Foundation. We'll try and understand from experts what needs to be done towards making the Indian roads safer. Joining us on the program are Karuna Rena, Director, Public Policy and Research, Save Life Foundation; Dr. A. Mohan Rao, Principal Scientist, Traffic Engineering and Safety Division, CRRI; and Mr. Abhishek Saxena, Public Policy Expert, Niti Aayog. I welcome all my guests and thank you for joining me on this edition of The Big Picture today. Karuna Rena, so let me begin the program today with you. The report that has been prepared by your organization as well as the World Bank primarily highlights the socio-economic burden of road accidents in India. So if you could take us through a few broad points related to this very aspect that find mention in your report.
Sure. So the report basically, as you said, looks at the economic and socio-economic burden and how poor people bear that burden disproportionately. And the idea was to, look at the impact of road crash outcomes in poor households. So for this particular study, what we did was we looked at two respondent categories, low-income households and high-income households. And what we found was that 75% of respondents from low-income households responded that there was a decline in their total household income post-crash. They also reported, almost roughly 7 months of income was lost, whereas in a high-income household, it was roughly 1 month. The medical costs was much, in terms of the whole pie, medical costs were a very important category where an out-of-pocket expenditure for medical cost was something which they had to bear. The other important aspect which we found was very low awareness about insurance and insurance mechanisms and institutional support which the government has in place. So a lot of people from and respondents from low-income households were not really aware of the mechanisms which are there. And that then really impeded, the support which they could have gotten from the state. The other sort of impact which we looked at was the gendered impact of road crashes. Now, it's a very common, fact that it's mostly men who die in road crashes. But what we wanted to study was what is the impact then left on people who are left behind. So what we found was that it's mostly the chief wage earner in a household, mostly male respondents who either are victims of road crashes and are, therefore there's mortality or morbidity, but it's the women who are left behind and they then face the burden of coping up with that in terms of finding another job, or there's time poverty, there is dip in terms of nutrition. They also have to make tough choices in terms of the, education of their children. So the burden on women, the study also tries to look at that. And then it comes up with certain recommendations for all these different things to ensure that the burden which poor people face due to this disproportionate impact is lessened.
Yes, so we'll talk about these recommendations and, ways ahead to reduce this financial as well as social burden of road accidents in India in the course of the program. But coming to you, Mr. Saxena, first. So one thing that Mr. Gadkari said while releasing the report, and very significantly, that road accident scenario in the country today is more dangerous, rightly so because of the alarming statistics on road accidents. And let me point that out for our viewers before I pose the question to you. So 1,50,000 deaths per year, 5 lakh people approximately getting injured due to road accidents, and over 70% fatalities in the most productive age group of 18 to 45 years. Now, if we compare that to COVID pandemic, where over 70% fatalities due to COVID-19 took place in the age group of over 65 years. So this clearly means that road safety today requires more rigorous attention. So in addition to what we've already been doing, and we've seen there has been significant work as far as road safety is concerned in recent years, but what more needs to be done, going ahead if we look at the alarming statistics as far as road accidents are concerned?
Thank you. And thank you for this question. As you rightly mentioned, the Honorable Minister is very right in saying that this is the bigger issue than the corona pandemic that we are dealing with. At this point of time, we are facing somewhere close to 1.5 lakhs annually. Yes. And you know that number is 10% of the global road crashes deaths that are happening. That is statistically alarming figure for us. And at the same point of time, a large part of those deaths happen in the productive age group. I think it is appalling at the same time if you look at another data of, you know, I think that is mentioned in the World Bank report also, that between the age of 5 and 29, road accidents is the leading cause of death. Beyond any health reason, beyond any cardiovascular diseases, beyond any NCDs, beyond any of the other causes of death. So I think the situation is pretty alarming, and I have no qualms in saying that we as a multi-stakeholder organization, and including Government of India, civil society, have actually not delivered result in this area. So this is something that we need to look at the priority. The demographic dividend that we are talking about at this point of time, we are losing a large population of that. And I think it was mentioned by the Honorable Minister also that if we even reduce our deaths by half, we can increase our GDP per capita by somewhere around 20-25% in next two decades. So that is a huge potential that we have. We are losing out on those. The idea is, at this point of time, see, transportation and road safety has a lot of agencies which have to do their part to encourage road safety as a whole. So I think it is very important that all the agencies, so whether it is traffic police, whether it is state transport, whether it is central government, all of it come together to devise a policy approach for this and take it up on a mission mode.
Absolutely.
The couple of points that come to my mind is, you know, setting up of a institutional policy mechanism around this, which we do not have at this point of time. So I think we need to have effective institutional mechanism. We need to have, post-crash care, which allows crash victims to reach to the hospital as the earliest. And we need to innovate at this point of time in terms of, let's say, urban design, road transportation, or in terms of moving towards intelligent transportation systems. So the idea is we make roads safer for people to walk, we make roads safer for people to cycle, because remember, this is the 50% of the fatalities are to the pedestrian cyclist and to the motorcyclist. So
yes,
we need to make our roads safer for them. So urban design, intelligent transportation systems, along with the institutional mechanisms, will play a very huge role in this.
Okay, Dr. Rao, so what Mr. Saxena suggests is that institutional mechanisms need to be put in place, because looking at the alarming situation that, you know, road accidents are occurring, and we have to ensure that our roads are safer. In that aspect, what we are seeing is that the state of Tamil Nadu is doing a very, very commendable job. In fact, the minister also spoke about it, because data shows back in 2014, more than 15,000 people were dying every year in the state from road crashes. Now, if we look at 2019, road deaths in Tamil Nadu have fallen to 10,000, which is a reduction of over 25%. What is it that the state of Tamil Nadu has done right to bring down the number drastically, which the other states also need to emulate?
Yeah, thank you very much for the question. Yeah, madam, actually, now all the institutions are focusing on mobility of the people. Okay, to mobilize the people from one place to another place. So it has to be, speed has to be increased. Then only we can quickly reach one place to another place people. In that process, actually the safety is hampering, because obviously you have to increase the speed. Okay, if you take road transport, it has to be compute with the rail transport. This transport speed has to be increased. Okay. So in that safety is hampering. But if we are not properly addressing the safety issues of the road infrastructure, then obviously accidents will inevitably occur on the road. If you see the ministry's data, it shows 50%, roughly around 50% the victims of the fatality victims are the two-wheelers and the cycle users and the pedestrians. Obviously, as published that World Bank report, these three groups are the marginally low income people. Okay, the impact of the accident on these group is the much more higher than the richer. They have a mechanism to recoup quickly, but these modes are the highly vulnerable, and they have high impact due to the road accident. But if you concentrate mobility, it's excellent. But same time, we have to take care about these groups to reduce the accidents or to avoid the accident by the road owning agencies.
Okay. And, you know, about the state of Tamil Nadu, sir, what do you think that they have adopted in recent years to have actually brought down the number of road accidents drastically by over 25%?
Yeah, obviously what they are doing, they are investigating properly, and the road accidents they identified, they are conducting the road safety audits for a particular roads before construction, even existing roads also. They are doing road safety audit. They are identifying where the accidents are taking place. That in ministry language, it is a road block spots. And they are targeting that block spot, they are rectifying so that the source of the accident is reducing. So obviously, ultimately result is accidents are reducing. Though that departments are the targetly achieving, focusedly doing some rectification mechanism, accident block spots. That's why they reduce the in a crash duration.
Okay, and the other states could probably in the days to come, in the years to come, replicate some of these ideas themselves to make roads safer. Karuna, coming back to you, there is no doubt the roads have to be made safer, and this is one area that requires increased attention in addition to what's obviously being done. So in that regard, what are the recommendations that the report has made?
So the report has made recommendations in six key areas. The first area, of course, is increasing awareness. Because what we have seen is that there's very low awareness amongst not even just low-income households and women, but also amongst truck drivers. So to give you an example, the third-party liability, for example, is something which is mandated by the law. And truck drivers, and of course all drivers' vehicles, need to have that. But we found the awareness about this very low. We also found awareness about the various mechanisms of the government which give compensation to be very low. So that's one key area which needs to be sort of looked at. The second is in terms of providing support to the families and to these households in a way which is quick and which helps them in the time frame in which they need that support. So for example, if it's micro insurance, or if it is ensuring that the people or the households where there has been a crash, the family directly gets a scholarship so that the children do not have to, you know, drop out of school. So mechanisms like that, where interagency coordination can be increased, is something what we have recommended that should be done. The third key area is to ensure that women, since also the minister is the MSME minister, you know, small and micro entrepreneurial models should be used, so that women who, because one of the things which women said while we were talking to them was that since there's burden of care on them, they also need to care for the injured. They can't move out looking for jobs. So models wherein they can work from, you know, from their house, but which also helps them in getting employed. That's something which needs to be done. And finally, there are mechanisms in the Motor Vehicles Amendment Act. There are sections there which, if notified, will help people a lot more. So, for example, there is one section on cashless treatment for victims, mm-hmm. which the ministry is planning to notify. So that would really help the victims, because one of the biggest cost components is the medical cost. And if the treatment goes cashless, that will really be a big source of reprieve for the low-income households. The yes. other area which would help would be interim compensation, which is again is something which the Act provides for. And finally, if we are able to, you know, look at the emergency care setup in total, that's something which would be very helpful. And I think that's something also which Tamil Nadu has done. They have really improved their response time. So post-crash, 1 hour, which is the most important critical hour known as the golden hour, if the victim is able to get treatment during that 1 hour, you can really help save their lives. So they've really improved on that response time. So these are the few key recommendations which are there in the report.
Okay, Mr. Saxena, so recommendations in the report in six specific areas. How can these recommendations be looked at by the government and be incorporated if we talk about in terms of policy?
Right. I think the recommendations in the report are fantastic. So it looks at the broad plethora of recommendations and interventions which we need to do. So this includes interventions in the areas of inequality in access to insurance or information asymmetry. But let me just step ahead in that and, you know, tell you a very holistic kind of approach to this. See, what is the biggest failure that we are looking at is, and I would say this is one of the biggest areas that we need to work towards, is the urban design that India has followed has largely been imputed from the Western countries of US and other European countries. Now, if you look at the travel patterns of India, and if you look at Census 2011 data, our 70% of the population is moving on foot or on cycles. The 15-20% is moving on motorcycles. But our roads are actually designed for people moving in the cars. Now, where do you see in the urban spaces or in the rural spaces, there are dedicated lanes for cyclists, there are dedicated lanes for, there are dedicated footpaths even. So in that sense, there's a strong disconnect in the type of people we are trying to move and the kind of mobility we want to achieve and the kind of urban infrastructure that we are developing. So at this point of time, you know, if I look at the vehicle sales also, the 85% of the vehicle sales is two wheelers and three wheelers is the number that we are talking about. But our roads are essentially, and I think as Dr. Mohan Rao has already pointed out, that we are looking towards speed. So that is not the idea with two wheelers and pedestrians and cyclists. So there has to be urban infrastructure which caters to that. And at the same point, it is very essential that we don't move towards a car-based system. Our infrastructure and our roads and our landmarks cannot just sustain that. India has only 18 cars per 1,000 population at this point of time, and you are seeing the havoc that the congestion is creating in our cities and the accidents it is pertaining. So as I think one of the panelists mentioned about the speed, and we are looking for more speed, the public transportation, and I include metros and mass transit into that, is the perfect way to go around that. And I think the report has rightly captured that there is a huge inequality in the burden of road crashes that actually falls into the low income household. So if we move towards a more equitable system, and which public transportation and mass transit is, so in that movement and in that transition, we'll be able to create more safer roads and more just transition. Along with that, interventions in the road safety, which is probably, you know, capacity building of traffic polices, adapting intelligent transportation system measures, improving road design, removal of some 800, 900 black spots which are in the country, which constitute a large portion of the road deaths. So these are the interventions that have to take place. But we also have to look at the paradigm shift on the mobility patterns that we are trying to build and where is it leading us to. So the idea is make the road as a whole more conducive, more safe and more equitable. And for that, there are institutional reforms and there are a plethora of paradigm shift that we need to take forward. And as I've already mentioned, that there is a transitional need to shift towards the models and the ideas that India needs at this point of time.
Absolutely.
So India, and you know, I've mentioned that India needs to move towards a public transportation system, not car-based system. And India has a large population which is actually traveling by foot and by cycles. We need to create dedicated lanes for them. We need to create safer roads for them.
Yes. Dr. Rao?
If you're taking pedestrians, in the road infrastructure, you have to give sufficient emphasis on building the footpaths and the footover bridges and subways, that we have to equally give importance to them, because to cross, to talk, to walk along the road, to cross across the road, we have to give emphasis on it. But sometimes what happens, they will construct roads excellently, vehicle speeds are the maintained, but these cross facilities are not there. That's why the poor pedestrians, they are not able to cross, or they are not appreciate the roads, and they are crossing, they are becoming one vulnerable road users. And coming to two wheelers, you see, two wheelers are the highest victims, it is more percentage. See, the speed variation between the two wheeler speeds and the car speeds are the much, much wide variation. It is a known, internationally known fact that if a same facility using with wide variation of the speed variance, it obviously leads to the accidents, because a small person is a slow moving vehicle using same facility, a high moving vehicle also moving same facility. So that we have to think to build a separate cycle lanes. If necessary, restrict the two-wheelers and search for alternate. But rather than that, we are building it and we are allowing all the road users to use the same facility. As a result, some sector of the people, they are not enjoying the facility. Rather than, they are becoming victims of using that facility.
Yes. So if we talk about the road ahead, sir, what are the road safety interventions that you would suggest?
Yeah, for it is very known, like pedestrians are the vulnerables, okay? Pedestrian facility are very well known in the engineering perspective. You build the footover bridges, subways, and the footpaths, don't compromise while building this thing. Or if you take two wheelers, if a highly express space, that design speed itself is 100. That space, we have to think about putting the separate lanes or the physical segregation of these two lanes, so that safety will be taken care by the infrastructure.
Okay. Karuna, one concluding remark from you. We have a target that has been set up to achieve reduction in road accidents by about 50% by 2030. So going forward, what more do we need to do to achieve this target?
I think we need a comprehensive approach. We need to follow all E's of road safety, as we call it. We need to make changes in the way we, the engineering aspect of roads. So for example, you know, like one of the panelists was mentioning, the way the roads are built, and how they are built and how forgiving they are for the road users, especially the vulnerable road users, it's very important to keep that in mind. It's important to have enforcement systems which ensure that various risk factors which are there, whether it's speeding or non-usage of, you know, safety devices, like people are able to change behaviors, or there's enforcement on these particular risk factors. And then the most important one is the, you know, emergency care. So if pre-crash, we are hoping to prevent this, post-crash emergency care again is a very important aspect. And I think on all of this sits data. To have robust data of crashes, to investigate these crashes, to make sure that we have data of, you know, where are the black spots, where are the deaths happening, how quickly are they reaching. If something, you know, we've learned from the Tamil Nadu model is that data is very important, because when you have data, you're able to see the whole picture. You're able to tell the whole story in a way that is compelling, but it's also impactful. So then to have that data at the national level and then use it to ensure that we are able to reduce number of road crash deaths and injuries in the country.
Definitely. So going forward, a lot of cost-effective safety interventions that are required if we have to achieve large welfare gains. And that is something that has also been pointed out in the World Bank report. For the moment, thank you to all my guests for joining us on the program and sharing your perspective on how to make Indian roads safer and reducing road accidents. At the same time, this will boost economic growth. It will propel India on the path to higher growth as well. Thank you once again for joining us on the program. So that's it from us on this edition of The Big Picture. Thank you for your time.